welcome to The Bizarre Briefing, the other show dedicated to the only show dedicated to social engineering at the bar and on the street.
All right. I'm just going to say, that's not our permanent motto. That's definitely not the direction I was going. But for today, that'll do.
Okay.
How you doing, Bryce?
I'm doing good. That's Brandt.
Yeah, Brandt Hughes.
And of course, we've got John Tilton.
Hey, I'm here too.
The three of us, minus Brian Rushwood.
Who? Sorry, who?
He has weird hair, and he eats fire, and he's like loud.
Not ringing a bell.
He hosts like a scam school. It's like people come in and they
sounds
learn.
Lame.
Yeah. Oh, I've been on that show before.
I feel like I've seen.
I'm sorry.
You on there before. You were
not
in a
sure
magazine.
Who Brian is though.
We're in a magazine about that twice.
Yeah.
So we, the three of us, make up the other side of Bizarre Magic.
We do all the stuff like behind cameras and out of the spotlight. And
Until now.
So I feel like it might be good to kind of kick off and talk about like what our roles are, because a lot of people don't actually know. I mean, I guess they kind of get a feel for what I do and sometimes what you do, Bryce.
Yeah.
Definitely nobody knows who John even is.
No, yeah. Like, well, and I think people, because a lot of the people that we're in contact with a lot are Night Attack fans, they think we're really in touch with Night Attack.
Yeah.
Like we handle a lot of Night Attack stuff, and like we don't. Like, I have people
literally asking, nobody handles Night Attack.
No, like the guys don't even.
Yeah, Brian and Justin don't. They're like, I don't know.
I don't know. It's Tuesday at 4 p.m.
Living
know.
Being on its own.
Yeah.
Kind of edits itself and uploads itself. Just a big blob of.
That's a really great way to describe Night Attack. Just a big blob of dot, dot, dot.
Yeah.
So I guess we want to start with John. Or do we want to start with Brandt? I feel like I shouldn't go because I'm the new guy.
All right, yeah, I'll go. I'll try to make it brief because it's been documented fairly well on a very important meeting and on Night Attack and everywhere else.
You've even done a lot of those YouTube live streams.
Yeah.
Of you doing work.
Yeah, that is a lot of what I do. So I started, you know, becoming aware of all of this stuff from scam school when it first started. And I was like, hey, this is kind of cool. And then I stuck around for a while and I started watching BB Live Show like right when it started, like 10 episodes in. And then I stuck around through NSFW Show, Game On, Night Attack, all that dumb stuff. And then, you know, it just worked out that I needed a job when Brian needed somebody to work for him. And so I applied, and because he knew me from chat, he was like, sure, come live in my house. For like a week. And then when I first started, the job was very different. It's kind of changed a lot over time. I know back when Chad was around, like, he kind of described his job the same, like it was always changing and always different. I think John even was the same around that time. And so like I started off doing stuff for scam stuff. Like I think I helped with packaging a little bit. I remember like one of the first things I had to do was like call banks for sequential bills, which was like the worst thing in the world for me personally. And I did like some one-off design stuff. And also I was touring with Brian a lot when he did a stage show. So I just kind of was his hands.
Yeah, Bryce is the first guy not to do the initiation
Lucky.
Of on the road work.
Yeah. And so I did that for like a year, and then I eventually got tagged on to do Scam School. So that happened in December of 2014. Wait, what's this year?
This is 2015.
Okay, so 2013. Yeah. And then for like a full 12 months, I exclusively did Night Attack every week and all the ads and all the behind the scams and all the remixes and all of that stuff. So basically video production, everything that wasn't live streamed. And then, you know, and then Bryce came along and that kind of split up my workload. Now I mostly just do Scam School and Scam School Remix, occasional behind the scam, and sometimes product photography, stuff like that.
Yeah. And like the glyphs, like
yeah,
the glyphs for the scam.
Yeah.
The
just
rogues.
Just occasional design work.
as well. I have to get you to do more of those, actually.
Yeah.
That's this show is it's going to be me John's remembering like, what I need to tell you guys to do.
Sure.
So then, John, because you've kind of had an on-again, off-again thing, can you fill people in a little bit about your origin story here?
Yeah. Well, I guess kind of similar to Brandt's in terms of I was graduating college and looking for a job, and then saw Brian was hiring and had a bunch of jobs that were related to things that I was less excited about than, you know, YouTube and kind of internet TV stuff. So, yeah, I started doing on the road stuff with Brian. This was back in 2011. And then while that was going on, we kind of came up with a plan that, that now actually is kind of what Scam Stuff is today. But also included, things like the Scam School eBooks, and just a bunch of different kind of things that we want to do on the side that would turn into something bigger down the road. And so, the Scam School books were definitely the first one, of that kind of thing. And so we released two of those. And then when we were working on the third book, I was actually looking for, to do kind of something else. I was a little tired of doing the on the road thing, which was still the main portion of the job at the time. And so we actually hired Brandt when I was looking for other work. And then, what always seems to happen when I think about looking for other work is I think, oh, let's do like one last kind of fun big project. And so we started the Indiegogo for Scam Stuff. And
let's do one last big project. Yeah. An entire new arm of the company.
Just for fun.
This is what happened. So we did that, and it ended up doing a lot better than I think either Brian or I thought. And it's funny looking back now, I guess it was kind of one of the small, the smaller things that Scam Stuff has done was at Indiegogo. But so we went through that, and then it was a ton of work, and we kind of realized that if we wanted to keep that kind of thing going, either someone needed to run the store, or I would have to stay on and kind of do stuff like that. So yeah, I guess there was a short period of time where I went home for like Christmas, and then I took all of my stuff back with me, and then
you
Brian
moved.
Was
it yeah, sounds like you moved.
Yeah, and then but I did leave some of it here because like Brian left it as like, well, maybe we'll keep doing the Scam Stuff thing, and then finally we had like kind of an official decision about it, and then I stayed in the area, and yeah. So ever since I've been doing Scam Stuff related work. I was working in Florida for some time too. But during that I was also doing Scam Stuff work kind of on the side.
Oh, I didn't realize you were working Scam Stuff in Florida too.
Yeah, there was probably 3 months where I wasn't as I was getting kind of situated. And then Brian actually had a show in Orlando, and then, he
roped
like,
you back in.
Yeah. He was like, why don't you just do the show with me here and I'll give you like, you know, whatever amount of money. And so I was like, yeah, sure, that'll be fun. Yeah. And then we ended up just talking about Scam Stuff things again, and he was like, yeah, like there's a lot to do with it, so if you're interested. And yeah, it seemed like it would be fun to kind of do that on the side. And then one of the big reasons I moved back in the area though was my wife had some research opportunities at UT in Austin that she wanted to pursue. And so, and at this point, like the stuff I was doing with Brian kind of on the side was taking up a lot of time too. So I was like, I should probably just do one or the other, not be overloaded with two jobs and getting married and, you know, all this stuff happening at once. So yeah, then Brian and I got talking again, and it was the whole, I guess now the ongoing joke is every time I leave, like my role just like changes or gets bigger or something like that. but yeah, it's a lot of fun. And it's like Brandt described, it kind of does change on, I don't know how often you feel like your role here changes, Brandt, but even with scam stuff alone, that changes every couple months in terms of like what products are hot at the time, or, you know, like for instance, we retired the scam pack completely last Christmas, and so like that's not a part of what we do anymore. But we do like the arson watch is probably our most recent, no pun intended, hottest item on the store, and sure. And so that it's actually been pretty hard to keep up with demand on that, and so. A big part is like every week, you know, assembling those. And at some point, you know, people won't, they won't want those as much as whatever new thing we're putting out the store. Yeah. And so it'll turn into that. But
so it sounds like maybe your day to day stuff changes from over time, but like the spirit of what you do is still very much like product development and fulfillment and customer service and stuff.
I would say now, like looking back when I first started with Brian, it, like we were trying out like stuff like the Scam School book and the On the Road thing and probably stuff that I can't even remember at this point. But that was like kind of big changes. The scam stuff thing seems to be there's general things we try to follow on in terms of like what I'm responsible for, I guess. Right. But yeah, the what we're assembling, there's a pretty good diversity there, and so that changes a lot. But yeah, it's generally assemble stuff, ship it over to our fulfillment center, write you know an email to tell people why it's awesome, that sort of thing. So that's kind of the general grind, and then the details make it different.
Right, because like I remember back when I jumped on and we had like the big holiday rush and stuff, and it was just like long days in the garage like putting together scam packs and stuff like that. And so at least
there's still some of that,
sure.
But yeah it's funny.
So like it's safe to say you are scam stuff like day to day.
Sure. I'm the
to make it easy to describe, I guess.
Yeah, but most things related to scam stuff is generally done by me. But I mean, Brandt and Bryce, they do all the video work for and most of the photography work for anything that we need. So like the visual aspect is not really me.
Mm. Also, I handle the scam stuff Twitter account.
Oh yeah,
so Brandt does do scam stuff. Brand management.
I should probably do that at some point.
Yeah,
but right now Brandt has done it.
Every now and then I get a tweet and I'm just like, "Hey John, I don't know how to answer this. Can you please give me an answer so I can tweet them?"
If it doesn't help me right now because I'm on my like random Twitter hiatus for like Star Wars prevention spoilers. Right.
Yeah, I was going to talk to you about that. It's
who runs the Scam School Twitter?
I think that's a Discovery Run thing.
Ah. Well, they've retweeted me a few times, but they also don't do anything.
Well, I think Brian might have access to it. I don't know if he handles that specifically. I don't know.
It's like the Nitech thing. It runs itself.
Somebody runs
sometimes.
It.
Yeah. It gained artificial intelligence. You know, some kind of AI, right. And now it's just like it's self-aware and it's like I know what I'm supposed to do. There's a new episode. I tweet about it. Mm-hmm. Here's the link.
Pretty much. It's just a big if then and that scheme.
Yeah.
Yeah. We should do that. We kind of need that. Some of those Twitter accounts don't, like Scam School doesn't post to Twitter anymore, I think.
Hmm.
Like it's been like months at least. And then like.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm pretty sure you're.
Am I wrong? I could.
You're definitely wrong. I mean, they tweeted 5 days ago.
No, they didn't.
Yeah, they did. I followed them on Scam Stuff. That's what I use Scam Stuff for. Scam Stuff, that Twitter account I used to follow the Scam School account and Brian's account. So that way I have easy notifications if either of them tweet.
Oh, so this must be hooked into Test Tube.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's... well, don't show me up.
They tweet all the time, Bryce.
But, man. Oh, man. Even going for... Okay. Well, right, okay. So I lied.
Thank you, John. That was good.
Yeah, sorry if that was longer than.
No, that's great. So Bryce, how about you? You're the new dude.
I am the new dude. I've been here almost about
for like a week, right?
It'll be coming up on 5 months or so.
Wow, that much already?
And that's just doing Scam School stuff or Bizarre Magic stuff.
Yeah, because you were here a little bit before that as well. Like
for a couple months. Yeah. So it's actually, I've been in Austin for about 6 months. When I was previously in Chesapeake, Virginia, and I was working for a local government TV station, which is as thrilling as that sounds. City council meetings, news packages, long form presentations.
Wow.
I know, though I will say, I now know some pretty effective tips to managing mold in your household.
Hey, that's useful information.
It's useful. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right.
Is that from like a special that the TV thing did, or?
Oh, yeah. That was a presentation.
Like, you have a mold problem in the office.
No. That is a little more. Okay. I'll clarify. Yeah. That was a long form presentation, a series of long form presentations that we filmed. And it turns out that I was listening to Brian record Behind the Scam in here an hour or so ago. And he was talking about when he was at Dell, he'd gotten a raise and it was good money. And he was worried that, like, he'd get stuck.
Yeah, spoiler alert for Behind the Scam. Sorry about coming that. Out soon.
And also Magic Magazine. It's in the Magic Magazine.
Right. Oh, there. Yeah.
And I had a very similar thought. I was at that job for about 2 years. And it was a very similar thought, because even though it was still also a small production crew, I mean, it's small like it was here. It was me and another editor and director or our supervisor, whatever. And it was just basically the three of us. And the money was good, and I got benefits and insurance and dental, and I had a retirement. I was saving for retirement, apparently.
Wow.
Yeah. And I hated it. Like,
just like the day-to-day work, like the whole the philosophy.
I liked the work, but I was bored out of my mind. Like even the hours were great for something that was like that you would have to do nights and weekends. Like, it's a pretty cushy gig, but I just kind of hated it. It was boring. I was thinking about the stuff that I was doing there. I need to get off this topic because now I'm just bashing the city.
Hot takes.
And I was getting bored, and I was doing music stuff on the side, and I was into NSFW show, then Night Attack. And I knew I'd come out to South by Southwest last year, last February or March.
Right.
And I watched the big show, and I got to meet Brian and Justin, and I got to spend some time with them. And I knew, as booming as Austin was, that by the end of the year, I had wanted to move to Austin, regardless of if I had a job or not. Because I had had some money saved up, and I wanted to change. Otherwise, I would have been stuck in what is now a cubicle, I have found out. For like ever. Oh yeah, there's me with the coif. Hold on, can we get a bigger shot? Yeah.
Wait, that's a picture of you?
That's a picture of me at South by Southwest. Are you gonna pass it to him? That was me when I had a faux hawk sort of thing.
I can't believe you threw your phone. I would never throw my phone, especially to me.
Oh no,
it's carpeted. It's fine. Oh, you would
Now it looks like you. It didn't look for like I was seeing it like on the screen here.
Right.
But you do have shorter hair here.
Yes. I did.
Yeah, he had a super.
It looks like this guy in the background's peeing.
Let me see. Right.
I mean, it's South by Southwest, so
he might be.
Yeah, he might.
He could be. That's a handlebar, that's a rooftop, so I mean. So I was literally on the plane back from Austin, and I was like, yeah, December 1, moving to Austin. Sometime over the summer, Brian got in touch with me, or I got in touch with him, and I let him know I was planning on moving to Austin. And he was like, cool shit's happening, and I can't guarantee you anything, but cool shit is happening. And he knew me.
Which is such a Brian thing to say.
Right. And you know, I had done the April Fool's scam stuff, one of the April Fool's scam stuff ads, and so I think it was in a similar position where he had just seen me and seen my work and was like, hey, we've got work that we need to do, Help. Can you hold a camera on a Scam School shoot, or can you do, you know, audio mix or something? Eventually, it was like we're trying to do new and more things, and also Brandt is doing everything, and that's a bad thing. He shouldn't be doing everything.
It was real bad. It was like unhealthy. It was really bad.
Well, because you were doing Scam School every week, an ad every week, a creative ad every week, by the way, and remix,
and Behind the Scam,
and all the design stuff,
and just so you know, I am very familiar with the 35-hour workday, and I had one about every week last year.
Yeah.
Sometimes once every other week if it was like a good month.
Yeah, and
so it was rough.
So I had moved down here and I was staying with a friend for a while, and it was just like, hey, you want to be hired? Here you go. And to disclaim for that story, because what I just told you was a very reckless thing. What I did was something very stupid.
I think
if it was anybody other than Brian, because that was my whole thing the whole time, was like, I kind of understand Brian a little bit. I feel like he wouldn't have said some of the stuff if there wasn't an inkling of an idea there. But there are some red flags in that story, and I don't think people should move halfway across the country to go to a job that doesn't exist then.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, your kind of thought was, it sounds like from you telling the story, that you kind of wanted to move to Austin, period, anyway. Right. And because it's a growing city, there's other stuff here too if it didn't work out.
Exactly.
Is that something you would encourage people to do?
I would say if you're in that time of, if you're in a place where you're like, man, I kind of don't like this exactly, and the geographic part of it was that geographically, if I wanted to keep doing video stuff, it would be news. It would either be news or weddings, just because there weren't a lot of ad agencies that weren't, except for like in Richmond, who do like the Geico commercials and stuff. There wasn't anything for me in my immediate area, and I knew if I was going to move, I might as well do it right. And so the worst case scenario would be I would be in Austin with $2,000 and a couch to sleep on and a skill set. So don't just move to Austin and expect a job from Brian Brushwood, because that's not how that works.
But yeah, a little
maybe
bit.
Maybe someday. When we're big enough.
Sure.
Yeah.
If all of you go right now to scamstuff.com and buy $200 worth of stuff.
Buy the Platinum Blessed watch.
And then do that every day for 5 years, then we can hire all of you.
We're basically Mars One.
Yeah.
We're just like, buy your stuff and hey, you know, maybe you'll have a shot.
We'll Skype you. We'll Skype you for psychological interviews and stuff.
But yeah, a little bit of insight. Like, I remember after that South by So Wasted, like pretty soon after, Brian was like,
it's a great
impression. What do you think about Bryce? And it's really funny talking about this when Brian's just like downstairs, but he
probably watching.
Yeah. It was very obvious that, you know, one of the big requirements for us working here is that we understand like the work environment, and like we mesh well with the, you know, the atmosphere that is provided by Bazaar Magic Inc. And it was very clear that, you know, you kind of fit into the crowd here. So he was
I'm glad to know that I'm cool. A
crowd of like three people.
Yeah. And so like it was one of the things that Brian's really good at is like he sees somebody that he wants to enable, and maybe enabling is not the best word, but support and make sure that they have a place to shine, and then finding like the proper avenue to push them into. Although it did take a full year to get me on Scam School, I'm just saying. So,
but it happened.
But it did happen.
Well, and You're saying editing Scam School as like the main thing you're.
Yeah, just like giving me video production work, because that's very clearly like where my strong suit
well,
is. And,
well, you remember though that the reason it took so long was because Revision 3 was still like it. Right, we had to go through and get.
It was a long process, just like behind the scenes.
Yeah, and so we started shooting it in Austin, and then it was being like Revision 3 wanted to find.
Their own production crew. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then it took that slow kind of convincing to say, hey, I think the show will be better, which I think it is. I think the other team was doing a good job, but I think it's better. And whether that's, you know, Brandt just being more talented or it just being closer.
Who's to say?
Better communication between someone who actually, you know, works with directly with Brian.
Right.
Or, you know,
there are any given number of variables,
a little bit of both probably, but, yeah, but it's funny to me that Bryce has never done the on the road thing, but it speaks for how, in fact, I think you're the first person that's ever been hired by Brian who hasn't gone on the road.
Yeah.
That was something that, I won't say scared me, but I thought I was like on a tightrope, and I was like, one day he's gonna be like, "Hey, I need someone to go on the road."
Well, it speaks kind of to the transition that I think Brian's business has seen in terms of having that a couple hundred shows every year versus today, where you know we're much more focused on the internet content.
Yeah, so. Mm-hmm. I would like to self attribute that to me.
Sure.
Well, when Brian was interviewing me and stuff, I was like, I made a very big point of like, I want you to focus on this, because as a consumer of your content, as somebody who watches your shows and stuff, I can't get anything out of your stage shows. I can't go watch all your stage shows. So if you're spending all of your time all year doing stage shows, like there's nothing for me to get out of that. So
which is easy to say, but at the any live performance will pay, you know, better than someone watching for free online.
Absolutely.
So,
yeah.
So it's been
although Patreon has helped a lot with that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
especially for the podcast.
Totally.
But also like for Scam School, like doing the ads for domain, like they are paid up through this year now? Is that what I've heard? Through March of next year. Yeah. Almost 12 months. Probably 12 months when they paid for it or when they put the order in.
Probably.
Because of like directly because of your actions and like skills. You're helping keep the boat afloat.
I'll take that one.
Good.
Yeah. It's my real claim to fame. Making all right palatable ads.
Well, and it's like You make great ads. I mean, I'm not trying to.
Sometimes,
Like the one that you just did, the one that you did in Dallas with your father.
With my dad, yeah. Kung Fu one. That was pretty good. One.
That was great.
Yeah. Fun little fact about that. Literally every time my dad's had paint swatches like painted on the wall like samples, I've always done a video in there. So like in his old house, I did a video as there was like big paint things on the wall, and then that ad was another one that was fun.
So now next time you're at his house and there's paint on the wall, you have to be like, what video am I supposed to do this time?
It's right,
like,
yeah,
watching paint dry, the ad
pretty much. All right,
so that's kind of our origin stories a little bit.
Sure.
It sounds like you had some other topics.
Oh yeah. Oh, totally.
Get some topics.
All right, maybe a little bit of how do you guys handle your balance between personal life and work life? Because I remember John told me about how important that was when I first got the job, like getting that balance right. And unfortunately, my personal life has mostly been like watching Night Attack and watching weird things. And like, so I feel like I'm starting to get a little bit more of a divide, but for a long, long time, that's always been so tightly, you know, unified that it's been tough for me to find.
Yeah, that seemed like a directed at me question.
Comma John.
Yeah, it's hard because I think any job these days with smartphones and, you know, soon smart watches on everyone. Yeah, it's very much a kind of always available society that I think anyone working today has. And so I think that's spread across everywhere.
Now you seem like you probably have the most regular schedule of us all.
I would guess that. I think right.
It's hard.
My work-life balance is a lot better than it used to be, but I think that's because what my responsibilities are now with scam stuff, I think, is more kind of in my hands versus, you know, I would imagine the video work you're doing, it's a lot of, well, we need this by then, and then, you know, it takes time to put that together.
Right.
And then on the road stuff, it's just impossible because you're
literally not home.
Yeah, you're held to that schedule. So it works out because, like, for me, what I end up doing, and again, I'm not saying that this is advice for everyone, because it really depends on what your role is, you know, whether you're one of us or, you know, if you're kind of taking this advice for whoever's watching, whatever job that they do. Yeah. But I know for me, something that's really important is I know when Webgistics, our fulfillment center, we recently switched to a fulfillment center out in Georgia. Instead of packaging everything here and shipping it off, we assemble things here and then ship it off to the fulfillment center. So they have their schedule, which is pretty set in stone. And so anytime there's like things that are address changes, stuff that needs work in terms of answering emails and that kind of thing, I know when I need to respond to those and fix them on kind of the back end of stuff. And so I kind of have a little bit my schedule, you know, set to when things need to happen for that. But I make it a rule with myself, if it's not one of those times, like, just, you know, stay off the... I basically keep all the scam stuff email running on the scam stuff email and not do too much from my personal email. There's an exception for a couple suppliers that we work really closely with. But... in general, I try to, and I have that in a separate app on my phone, so it's not in my normal email app.
Right.
And then it actually helps two ways, because, you know, it doesn't invade kind of some personal time, but then also it...
it's organized.
Yeah, and so I won't miss anything. Not that I won't miss anything, but it's less likely that something will get lost in my emails. Because that was the thing, it used to be, everything used to just be in my normal email. And then I'm such like a OCD person about like making sure my, you know, iPhone doesn't have a red dot showing how many things. Like, I hate that. I should probably just turn it off. But I also like knowing when something's new.
Right.
Yeah. So that's probably one of several things that I do for it that comes to mind. But yeah, it's tough. But I think it's tough with a lot of jobs today because of that connectivity. And then the expectation there comes, and I would think when I was working in Orlando too, it was the same thing where just, you know, having that calls all the time when you're supposed to be off, that sort of thing.
And so
I don't know if there's a true like time on and off like there may have used to been, but
right,
I was never working during that time either, so I don't know if that was just kind of a, you know, just a imaginary time that never actually existed. Sure, so. Sure.
And Bryce, so you do some work from here in the studio, but you also do a bit of work at home, same as myself.
Right.
So for me, like, working from home makes it especially hard to have any kind of division between work and not work, because it's all just happen at the same time.
Right. And you're kind of tempted. I think that's my thing when I'm working at home, is I'm tempted to just like do other stuff. And it's partially because I have TV and a living room and just like space where I don't need to be working that is like taunting me. But it's also probably a little bit because there's not like somebody looking at me being like,
are you on dig right now? You shouldn't be on dig.
That's why you need a giant poster of Brian on your wall where you work at home. And everybody it just says in huge texts, "Are you on dig?" ? And then whatever you're struggling with during that kind of week, you just replace dig with.
Oh, we'd do whiteboard.
Yeah, like you could have a little whiteboard and just change it.
I do have a whiteboard in front of my laptop that I don't use for that.
Whiteboard is so great.
Like, oh, is it?
I love it. I use it for keeping track of like release schedules and stuff because that's gotten kind of complicated with Vessel and stuff. So so it's nice to have like a layout of my week up on that. I used to have it for like long-term goals, but then I realized that, oh, this is just staying on my whiteboard for 8 months. That's not really helpful. So,
yeah. Another thing that's important with kind of the balance stuff is I always think kind of feeling out how important different items are to you. So, like, you know, I'll catch myself a lot. Or when I do answer email at a time, you know, that might be not my typical working time. There might be something where it's like, oh, I just caught something that's really important. I should do it right now. But then there's other stuff where it's like, oh, that's easy. I can do it right now. And then there's 15 other things like that. And then the right now ends up being 3 hours of work. So, but I don't know. It's also kind of a keeping track of how long you're spending on something. And I always find if I give it a rest to and come back to it later, I end up being more efficient with it. And
yeah,
that might be, I don't know if you find that in video editing. I know I find that when I'm assembling stuff in the garage. So,
well, I think Brandt and I probably have totally opposite approaches on that because I'm kind of with you, John, and I like to start early and then do it in bursts. So that I can kind of get that sort of new fresh perspective every so often. But I think it could have just been like a practical part on how much you had to do, Brandt, that you don't work that way, ?
Yeah, it's kind of ingrained into the way I do things now a little bit, where it's just like I work a billion hours all at once for a really long time. But yeah, like it was definitely born out of, I mean, I guess I've always been a little bit of kind of a procrastinator, push it off to the last minute, and that stress will pull out like the really good work out of me. But with all the craziness of last year, that became a real necessity. So this year I'm trying to like kind of push it into a little bit more of a, I'll do things a little bit early, but I still end up with a lot of days where it's like I have no other option than to start it the day before and just work throughout the night. And also for me, one of the big things, and this is one of the reasons why my sleep schedule is so messed up, because I know my sleep schedule is far different from either of yours, especially John's.
Mine is swaying towards yours though.
Right. Yeah. Cause I've seen you up in chat till like 3-4 AM or whatever.
About right.
Yeah. For me, I go to sleep like 6-8 AM depending on the day, depending on the work. And then, you know, I try to go to sleep right before sunrise so that way I can fall asleep and pretend that at night. But for me, yeah, like there's this weird thing with video work that I found that momentum is so important. So like the hardest thing is always like getting started for any kind of project, whether it's video work or whatever. So once I've gotten started, like I can build up momentum and I get kind of in the flow and the rhythm of things. And so I'll just work until I like pass out just about, just to keep things going. Because I know that like it's super useful to go to sleep and come back with a fresh perspective. And I think that's super important with video work. That's why I try to do everything at least one day early, so that way I can sleep on it one time and come back and review it. But it's also tough because once you've slept on it and you come back to it, then you have to like start all over again and you have to kind of build up into the workflow. But yeah, it's a whole mess.
Yeah, I mean I definitely get some of that. I think the technical term is creative flow. fun fact.
That sounds good.
Yeah. And definitely, you know, that experience of just like, I'm on a roll, I got this, is definitely, I would say, more the net positive of that outweighs taking it in short bursts and kind of keep rechecking.
Mm-hmm.
Because it really is it's really, you get to a crazy level of efficiency when you are just like, yeah, blinders on.
Right.
But I think sometimes I'm a little like work ADD. Like if you've ever seen me make music, I've done like live stream music.
Yeah, you bounce around projects a lot.
I bounce around a lot, sometimes between two or three songs at any one time. And I'll be working the whole time because I think what I found, at least with music, and this has probably bled over into video, though I don't get as much to bounce around for video, is that if I bounce around, I am less likely to get stuck on something,
mm-hmm.
especially with music, which is so open-ended. I'm less likely to get stuck up on something that I don't like and break that flow. And even if it's just going back and forth and just keep listening to song, the different tracks, that momentum really is so powerful, especially when it is very hard to get going. Like I pulled up my schedule for Sunday. I started working on the new Scam School on Sunday, and I had blocked out, you can see I've like blocked out my whole day. That's not gonna work. I've blocked out like my whole day from noon to midnight. Scam School, Weird Things, do the back end of Weird Things, and then Scam School. But I didn't get started on Scam School until like 10:30 at night instead of at noon when I said I would. But then I was also up until 3 a.m. working on it. And I was actually periscoping it, which also like really, I feel like, helped me out a lot. Because that's sort of...
Then you got the people watching your back. They're like, wait, are you on dig right now? Oh, he's just on dig.
Exactly. Like, I knew Roberto was watching me, and I knew Sunbun was watching me for a little while, but then Sunbun passed out or something. And knowing that there was someone there, and I wasn't trying to entertain them, but I was definitely trying to not be dead air.
Yeah, there's a little element of accountability in that.
Sure. Yeah. And so... I had gotten way farther than I expected to on that episode that night. And so doing stuff like that has helped.
Yeah. Sorry, John. Just real quick. When I did my live stream stuff, like I got kind of a similar vibe from that. It's tough for me because I have difficulties working while people watch, which is kind of... It's kind of a problem with like shooting stuff.
So you need to fix your Brian turned away.
Yeah. and that's always been a problem with like my photography stuff, and that's been a problem with like editing stuff. Like there are certain things that I just can't do if people are watching. Like I just need to like get in a zone, and I need nobody else to be there. I need it to be a solitary thing. But like as far as like scheduling stuff goes, the advent of Vessel, you know, even though not a lot of people actually are watching our stuff there, it's helped so much with my scheduling because it forces me, because we push the AR feed there,
yeah,
which doesn't have ads or anything, and so like it forces me to on one week do the actual episode and on another week do the ad, since they both take about the same amount of time.
Right.
Previously, I would just all crunch that into like a 48-hour period. Now it's actually split up over 2 weeks, which is really nice.
I'll say, even though I was only doing, you know, whole episodes every 2 weeks, like you were saying, it's like a lot nicer to sort of be forced to split them up like that. I mean, I guess you could do them in the same week and then just not. But like, it's really great.
Yeah, it's super helpful to have like a serious deadline. Like you have to have it up here. Like you are contractually obligated to have it up at a certain time, and give or take a couple hours. And like you could say, hey Brian, I need a deadline, but like if it's not real, your brain knows that, like it doesn't mean anything, there are no stakes. So yeah, having that split is super helpful.
I kind of get a little bit of that with the fulfillment center, because there's, you know, unless we're overnighting it and losing money off of everything we sell, then there is a time period where it needs to be ready out one day and just be on its way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so that helps a lot with, you know, there will be days where I just need to keep a lot of momentum, keep going, even if I'm losing efficiency on it, just to, you know, meet a deadline. But luckily, you know, we're in a situation with that where we can say, hey, it ships, you know, a day after you buy it or whatever. You know, there's a little bit of delay there. Mm-hmm. But I never like to do that because I don't like, you know, stuff going in the back order, that kind of thing. So,
right.
Yeah. But
yeah, like it all plays into time management, which is so tough. Like if you have a deadline, it's easy to say, okay, I have until this time to get it done. I know it'll take approximately this amount of time.
And these are the other things I have to work around.
Right. And so you can kind of fit it in where you feel it fits appropriately. But like if your deadline is super loose or you don't have a deadline, it's just kind of we could kind of use it, but whatever. Then it's so hard to like just motivate yourself to fit it into your schedule. Cause it's like, why even bother?
Well, yeah, I'd say doing the release every week too, or a release or something every week for us on scam stuff has really helped with that. Just mm-hmm. in terms of like having that kind of, oh, you know, every Friday we're doing an email out, that kind of thing. And it does help kind of the rest of the week kind of falls into place for what I know should be needs to kind of be done. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, it needs to be ready on Friday. So they have to get it by X day and then you have to send it by. We started this topic talking about splitting work time and personal time. But I don't think we talked so much about finding personal time.
We're like, none of us have personal time.
I know I'll say for me, like for a while, and I try to do it when I can, like Saturdays are good days for me because it's just far enough away from scam school where there's still some leeway.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also it's a weekend. So like I will try to do like Twitch stuff on Saturday. Sometimes I try to do Super Streamer Day, which is just like all, like if I can get all of my video gaming or just entertaining people out of the way on one day for 6 or so hours, then I don't feel so obligated throughout the week to be like, try to do stuff. Like I can know at least I will try to set aside some time where I'm having fun, and I'm trying to do Twitch stuff, which is like another thing I just want to do. Do you guys have like, do you have any like personal time that you try to make an obligation for?
Not really. a lot of my personal time is spent either doing one of two things. Either one, like trying to come up with some ideas for Cosmic Radio TV content, because I feel like, you know, it would be nice to have like a whole bunch of stuff over there. And the all the other stuff that I do is like watching Giant Bomb or watching Netflix or something. And you know, when the way that my brain works, once I get like hooked into one little thing, I just dive into it, and then I'm like, I'm not gonna work until this is finished. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, Daredevil comes out and I'm just like, sorry Brian, I'll see you in a couple days. And then,
thank God that was a Friday.
Yeah, well, actually, Daredevil took me a long time to get through. It took me 3 days to get through, and I did all of that on my vacation, so.
That's right. You were on vacation, too.
Yeah, well, I was working during my vacation, but it was a vacation. It was the most vacation-themed vacation I've had since I started,
basically. Where did you go?
Dallas. Somewhere? I went up to my dad's house. Okay. Yeah. And I just kind of hung out with the fam because it was my birthday.
Cool, good stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, what about you, John? I mean, I guess you probably have more like a more normal people time.
Yeah, it's schedule. The fulfillment center helps with that. I take Sundays off pretty much completely. That's mostly for like religious reasons, though. But it works out nice because the fulfillment center doesn't do anything on Saturday or Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
So then there's no need to even have any communication going on. Yeah. And if you drop packages, you can't drop packages off anywhere on Sunday anyway. So basically that ends up all working really well. But it's really nice there, because it's kind of like today ends up feeling like a refreshed day kind of, and you get that kind of consistent new start every Monday. So if I have a week where I'm just like, oh man, I'm so behind on everything, like everything's just going horribly, there's not enough of whatever, then you know Monday kind of comes after a day of not looking at work, and then I'm like, oh, this is all actually really doable, and then, yeah. And then I don't get as stressed out about it. So but
I would say that's like
usually my flow
similar to that. Thursday, Friday, or Saturday is a similar thing, at least for me, because that's after Scam School, which is the big gotta get it done super serious deadline, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so if I am trying to schedule something with someone, I know I can say, well, Thursday is probably gonna be a good day because I don't have anything set to be due, you know.
Yeah, you kind of, it's that, you know, the it's rest you get that. After
yeah
finishing, you know, a big thing.
Exactly.
And yeah, like that's always nice too, because yeah, on days, like there will be days where it's either I'll stay a little longer for something, or it'll just be like a lot of stuff needed to get done, and then you kind of get caught up with everything, and then yeah, it's like then when you go home and play a video game, it's like that much more awesome, because you're just like, oh, that's not you don't hanging have on my
yeah
my back right now. Yeah.
Yeah, with like as crazy as our production schedules are and stuff, because that changes day to day
constantly.
Like it is nice to have the anchor of Wednesday. Wednesday is like nothing can happen on Wednesday because both Bryce and I are totally locked down and we're trying to hit deadlines. And then like Thursday for me is always like a burned day where it's just like I am sleeping all day because.
You were just up the past 48 hours.
Right, yeah. Like, I physically cannot do anything other than rest.
Although then we usually have Scam School shoots. So.
We do.
But and does that come enough time, or is that just like, oh, man?
Because that's kind of
it depends
sometimes.
Yeah.
It
depends on. There are some weeks where it's just like, oh, we're doing kind of an early shoot, and also I stayed up for a billion hours, and then I got 5 hours of sleep that night,
yeah.
And then... It's really bad then, but sometimes I'm able to shut it off a little bit earlier and then
get is it like some adrenaline? Cuz I've had that when I've done all-nighters where at some point it's just adrenaline kicking in keeping you awake.
You're like, I'm not even I'm human. Not hungry. I can just keep going.
I'm not tired.
Well, there's your first wind and your second wind, right? So your first wind is everybody's normal day. And then you hit about 8 a.m. and then you are almost dead. And then by about like 11 a.m., you kind of get a second wind. And for whatever reason, like you just re-energize a little bit and you feel kind of miserable. You feel like your brain is saying, hey, you're dying. But
you're but also, it won't let you bleed.
Right. Yeah, like you have an awareness that you didn't have in that little lull. Mm-hmm. And then you're very much driven by your will at that point. But yeah, it's not too bad. It kind of helps to have sodas.
Yeah. I have to bring sodas to Brian's house sometimes because they only have diet and non-caffeinated stuff. So
are you guys coffee drinkers at all?
No.
Yeah, neither am I. That's weird. Really? It's weird that's to weird. Find a...
It's like if we were all like left-handed people.
Just yeah, right yeah.
Now.
I guess Brian doesn't really drink coffee either, but he drinks soda. I don't really drink soda either.
Well, and he's big on diet soda.
Hmm. Yeah,
or beer. I guess I'm.
Yeah, sure. I would say he's pretty big on beer.
Well, yeah. But he tries not to be. Oh well, I'm not going to talk for Brian. Yeah.
I think Brian has a problem.
Yeah, I don't really. Everyone always thinks it's weird that I don't drink coffee, but I guess you guys don't either.
I don't either.
That's what I should say. I said, yeah. No one I work with. A lot of people don't
drink coffee.
Yeah, we got your back.
Real people don't drink coffee. I don't like coffee and I don't like potatoes.
Yeah, I've always.
Okay, y'all got some weird. You have some
Mr.
weird.
Mr. Shredded Lettuce.
Okay, oh, shredded
you
lettuce. Got
some. You don't like shredded lettuce?
I don't like shredded lettuce.
Yeah, he likes normal lettuce, like but he doesn't lettuce. Like shredded lettuce.
What's the difference?
Texture, apparently.
Texture. Mouthfeel. Mouthfeel.
I mean,
I can kind of get that, I guess.
Well, I mean, when you eat lettuce, it becomes shredded lettuce in your mouth.
That no. is true.
No.
It absolutely does.
It's not. What?
But hey, I'm weird with food too.
Yeah.
So.
Like,
what's the weird food? Because mine's potatoes, where everyone's like, no one in the world.
Everyone's like, you don't like french fries?
Yeah. And then it's like, yeah, no, really. Anything with potatoes in it, like even potato chips, after I have like two of them, it's just like, oh, it tastes like potato. But so, like, what's your food thing?
That, go ahead.
Oh, my. Where do I begin?
You have a lot. You have a lot.
So, I do like chicken, and sometimes I like beef. I don't like any other meats.
Bacon?
Pork, that's fish.
No. Oh,
okay, bacon. So that's your potatoes.
Bacon is nauseating. Like, wow. I get sick around the smell of bacon.
I see.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are a billion things I don't need. I don't need any condiments. Seafood. I don't eat most condiments. Like, I'll ketchup if I need to. But, like, I'm big on barbecue sauce. But, like, mustard, mayo, mayonnaise, like, no. No, ranch.
Not even like ranch.
Dressings. No. Oh,
that's right. I'm kind of starting to remember that I knew this about you already. So like, was that like rough on the road with all the
a little the bit,
stuff,
but
or do you kind of.
But like, we found that like Ryan and I order the same thing from Wendy's, so that goes a long way when you're on the road. But you know, there are enough places to keep me afloat for sure,
or enough ways to tell them what your preference is.
Yeah, sure. Every place sells chicken. Like, I can just order chicken somewhere. Like,
yeah. Whatever. I guess, yeah, shredded lettuce is, like, mine. Like, the thinly shredded. Like, you know, like...
Like what Subway okay. gives that's you? Like what Subway puts on,
what Subway or Taco Bell uses.
Okay.
Like, mushrooms.
Now, have you... So, like, when I'm making tacos or something, like, I start with big lettuce stuff and I cut it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, would that bug you too? Or is it more this like artificial shredded lettuce?
It's the long stringy shred.
So that might also be a thing where it's like, because I don't know how good that lettice is in the first place.
Yeah,
I don't
sure,
know
sure,
I
sure.
like that lettuce.
Right.
Yeah. Like, I mean, it's probably not like top shelf premium grade lettuce that they're shipping in there.
At Taco Bell, you think?
Who knows, Bryce?
Because I grew up on Taco Bell. But I also grew up understanding that that's what lettuce was the.
I hope that's like
color.
I hope that's the byline on your Wikipedia page. I grew up on Taco Bell, Bryce Castillo.
Hey, I'm down for it. Down for it.
Somebody in chat asked about nuggets. I'm just gonna say like I used to be big on nuggets, but I kind of grew out of nuggets. Like I'm more of like a tender kind of person. You know?
Okay.
Like I like a little bit more
strips?
Substance.
What about strips?
Yeah. Strips, okay. Good strips.
HEB has good strips.
Yeah.
Good frozen strips. Yeah.
Hmm. I just cooked up some chicken 2 days ago.
Oh, cool.
When I was waiting on behind the scam footage, I was just like, well, I got nothing else to do, so I'm gonna cook up all this chicken I bought.
See that? Well,
so
that's
some breasts.
That's the other thing in terms of like personal and like work life. Like you definitely have to, like, if you're ever waiting on anything, like I always make that okay. If I don't, I'll either do something else I have to do, or it's like, okay, this is time that I might not have later, or if something needs to be done late, then like I need to shift my work schedule with it. Now for me that doesn't happen too often anymore. Mm-hmm. But
well, and that's like really smart. Like I think that's a real analytical approach to it. And I know sometimes I don't have a very like if I'm in the same position where I'm like waiting for something, I just get panicked and stressed. I need the
easier said than
gone.
Done. Easier said than done.
Yeah.
And for me, like a lot of the waiting stuff is it's like being on call or whatever, where you just kind of have to, like, your job is to wait. And so, like, I'm as stressed as if I were working any other job.
I see.
And then, because usually it's as soon as you get the footage, okay, get it out, go. And it's just, like, nonstop once it comes in. So you can't really, like, so Saturday I was waiting for that footage and, you know, like, I can't go to the grocery store because if I'm at the grocery store and then the footage comes in, like, that's going to postpone all my work by, like, an hour.
See, I don't really have anything that is that affected by it.
Yeah.
because like your the video stuff mm-hmm. takes just so long to do in the first place.
Sure.
When it needs to be out fast. I can see how that's a thing. So sorry, my tips don't apply to you.
Sergeant Muffin edited my DCTVpedia page.
Excellent. Let's see where... Bryce Castillo, Neshcom, or Brycaz is a dude-type being who grew up on Taco Bell.
There you go.
Fun fact.
Oh, yeah, I think mine does say I don't like potatoes on it already.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
What does Brian not like? Is it like pickles and he doesn't like strawberries?
I didn't know he didn't like strawberries.
I think he has a strawberry thing.
He definitely doesn't like pickles.
I think he was worried about allergies with strawberries.
Okay.
For the kids.
But yeah, I think doesn't pickles like make him convulse just about hearing.
Probably
pickles?
How you feel about the bacon and I feel about potatoes. I think pickles is his thing. Because I know he doesn't like the kind of the juice of the pickle either. Like if you like put a pickle on a sandwich and then take it off, it leaves that juice.
Sure,
stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't like pickles either. And so I know what he means because you can taste it. It does feel
like there's
a little pickle stuff on it.
Oh yeah, and it's
I don't like it, but I can tolerate it. Like for him, it's like if you snuck.
I'm that way with mushrooms. Like I will, if I accidentally eat mushrooms, I will gag. I will struggle to get it down because I know, oh, it's in my mouth, and it's not like a pickle where you can taste. You know, oh, I'm eating a pickle, and this is not the thing I want to be eating right now. It's like, oh, I feel that this was not a sliced potato. It was like a mushroom, and it's in my mouth.
Sounds like our next podcast should be about
bizarre fooding.
Bizarre food.
I mean, we're basically the Giant Bomb cast. All they do is talk about food for like 3 hours every week.
It's a fun topic.
Yeah. For whatever reason, like I've always been like real big on pickles. Like just
so you love pickles.
The way that my taste buds work, like
so
that's
like Chick-fil-A is your thing because it's chicken
and pickles.
And the pickle. You get pickles.
Yeah.
On the pickle.
And the chicken's actually like marinated in pickle juice and some other stuff.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
So, yeah, there's a little bit of pickle in.
Don't tell
the
Brian that.
I was going to say, that's like, we need to keep that away from Brian because doesn't Brian like Chick-fil-A?
He does like Chick-fil-A.
For now.
He doesn't like when they get pickles on it.
Yeah. Okay. So
we're at about an hour. So, if we've got one last segment we want to do,
yeah.
Or topic.
Sure. I've got a thing, and this will apply to John most primarily. So this past week, I think I'm done watching Night Attack Live. I think I'm just not going to do it anymore.
Wow.
And I think you kind of made that jump a long time ago, right?
Yeah, I would say you probably watched Night Attack / NSFW longer than... Because I guess we've probably been... With my kind of little hiatuses, we've probably been working around the same amount of time because I think you came about a year on to...
December 2012.
When it was, yeah. So I guess that would have been...
2 years, 5 months, something like that.
I was mid-2011, so like a year and a half or something. Then you came on. And yeah, like I found it was... going back to the work kind of life balance thing, it got really difficult... to watch it, like when I first started working for Brian, in fact NSFW is probably the reason like I was most interested in working with him, because I thought there was a lot of really novel stuff going on with that show, and again probably still is, but
I've heard great things.
And I think you find kind of the biggest fans there too. I would say it started getting really difficult when I started dating Kelsey, not because she has anything wrong with the show,
right.
But just because it would be, well, now here's another thing that
is taking
another
away your
thing.
Attention.
Sorry, another part of life that takes up a lot of time, and so it, and then too, like kind of the workload was going up as well, and so it got to be a thing where I was like, well. During the time I don't need to be working, maybe I don't want to be watching my boss do something. And so even while having a lot of respect for that show and thinking it's really well done.
You're just like, Brian, you don't need to invade my home.
Yeah, it was something that I then made this decision. I should not watch it every week. And then it kind of became a thing where I got out of the loop with it. And then it just didn't become part of my, you know, the things that I know about. So, I would say it was directly, for me, it was directly related to starting dating Kelsey, who I'm now married to. But not saying that you can, if I was married, I could still watch the show, whatever.
You're virtuing right now.
sorry. but then also, work stuff becoming more intense in terms of more responsibilities, that sort of thing. And I'd say it's kind of those two reasons for me. But so you have a similar experience recently, which I did not know about.
Why the No More Live?
Yeah, and who knows if I'll even continue watching stuff unless I hear like there's this incredible episode like.
So you're just talking about live
or in totality?
So you watch it later?
I'm not sure yet. I haven't seen last week's episode, and
last week was a good one.
It's like it's been like a culmination of things for me. So weird things I haven't watched in a billion years. Although I think it's a great show. Like I'm just a year and a half behind.
Mm-hmm.
And then Court Killers, I haven't really watched since their jump from Frame Rate. Because I used to watch Frame Rate mostly to do like show notes stuff. But then when Court Killers kicked up, I think we have Beatmaster doing show notes on the wiki, or somebody handles that for the most part.
Maybe Toucan Monkey. Is somebody in chat. Who's
people handle that now. And also like new shows are tough for me because like it's like a news list rundown, whatever. Although Tom's the best. Obviously Brian's all right. Night Attack is this weird thing where there are absolutely like transcendent moments. Like Ghost Dad is one of my favorite episodes of any podcast ever. Like it's really great. It's super awesome. But there are just enough episodes where like it doesn't really land for me, and also I'm kind of making this this kind of jump towards more focused on like produced shows instead of live produced shows, because I just really don't like the feel of live produced shows because it feels like lazy to me.
I mean, definitely with live it's a lot of like we got to take it or leave it, and it's got to got to make it work.
Yeah, totally. Whereas, like, if you look, I've really been getting into over at GameSpot, they've got a feature called The Point, and it's like this awesome, like, super slickly produced show about video games and culture and stuff like that. And like, it kind of made me realize that I really love, you know, that kind of element of telling a story and being able to put it together in a really interesting way instead of just like a improv. But also for a long time, so you probably noticed this on the board, Bryce, but like months and months ago I put like community management on our whiteboard downstairs. Mm-hmm. Where we keep track of like our projects and stuff, because for a long time, you know, I was working on Diamond Club TV content aggregation.
Yeah, you were putting a lot of man hours into getting that the very like kind of hard to use old Diamond TV Club's Diamond TV script.
Like hundreds of hours into digging up videos and putting in details of
and redoing NSFW.
Oh my god, those are the worst.
Yeah.
And just keeping up with all that stuff. And then also like, you know, I was in chat for like 24 hours a day just about, you know, and I'm there like talking to people who need to talk to people. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, Brian's not exactly the most approachable person. His, you know, he always talks about his email. He's like, anybody could contact me at my public email. I don't know why it's such a problem. Yeah. But then it's like, oh, I have like 50,000 unread emails or something, you know? So like I'm more accessible than that. And with John's like hiatus from social network stuff, like sometimes it's easier for people just to tell me to tell you to do something.
Sorry.
Yeah. So like Sign's been meaning to email you for a while. And although he's like married now or something.
Yeah, he got married.
Yeah,
since,
it's crazy.
He went away.
Wait, anyway, who is this?
Sign? Sign, Brian's black son.
Brian's black son.
It's a Night of Tech thing. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. He's a character from chat, basically.
And a real person.
He's a cool dude.
Yeah.
And so...
So you're doing all of these different things.
Yeah, and then I started realizing that, like, this stuff that I did for fun, like, that personal sector of my life is now becoming work.
Sure.
And then also... Yeah. Bryce, you helped out so much because now you're in chat all the time and you're helping like Diamond Club TV. And I'm like, well, I don't necessarily have to always do this.
Yeah. Oh, no. So I didn't realize that was I'm happy. I'm in chat all the time because I also like you work from home and have my computer on all the time.
Yeah.
And am happy. And I do take a lot like for weird things and cord killers. I already take I liaise for the hosts on that a little bit, so like yeah, absolutely, you don't feel like you got to do it 24 hours, especially because like talking about personal time again, like that is taking up like social stamina, you know, that you could be dedicating to something you wanted to do instead of feeling a little obligated to do.
Yeah, and sometimes like I feel like an obligation to go check out like people who are streaming from chat realm like Curly and April, even though they're kind of on the fringe of chat realm these days, but also just people like Trickster, who's our Australian Diablo streamer who streams at like 4 a.m sometimes, and Sergeant Muffin and all these people. But sometimes like I jump in there as an obligation to be like, you know, manage the brand of chat realm and Diamond Club, and like it's really important to always have somebody who understands what's happening. Like that's the only way that you can really progress forward is if you have like
people who know a
full insight. Right. Yeah,
because like Brian, for as busy as Brian is, you know, the time that he spends in chat room is when he's recording a show. Usually, sometimes he'll pop, it's funny, like he'll pop in when he's not doing anything, and I will be like, hey Brian, what's up? What do you need? Because I expect him to you know, need us to distribute.
He's
something.
Like, quick, I need the link to Night Attack Doc. Oh, come on, Brian.
So when there's stuff going down with admin or moderator stuff, it's like he doesn't even know. Right. Like, so somebody somebody should know what happened and what was done and needs to be able to make a call without defecting to Brian.
Yeah, he definitely relies on the eyes and ears of us to
see all
to relay the important stuff that goes on. But yeah, so like that took up a lot of time and it was very like, this is work. And then, you know, also Night Attack happens on a weird night for like production stuff because it's Tuesday night, which is a big thing for like getting Scam School done.
Yes.
And it's a big time investment. It's like 6 hours some weeks and sometimes even more, like doing all the pre-show and doing the show and the post-show and managing people and telling people to shut up about the pre-show and giving everybody links to the doc even though it's in the topic and doing like all that just micromanaging stuff. And when I could
and it's
be,
not fun so no, a lot of it's not
it's not it's infuriating
pre-show.
And also it's like I could be doing work right now.
Yes.
And so that's, you know, that's been for a long time. And then also, you know, there have been a couple times I missed episodes. Like I missed, I think episode 5, that was one with Casey McKinnon.
Oh yeah.
Pretty early on that I just missed and then never caught up on. But like I skipped this week's and I was just like, okay, well, I think what happened is I got aggravated in chat because Bryce, you'll be acutely remembered of this. Everybody was quote chatting everybody. They were just copying the text that somebody would paste.
But it would include their nickname. Yeah. So it would ping everybody.
Yeah. And so it would just be like a string of 30 names and then like a sentence. And it's just like the most annoying thing in the world to me personally. And then so I was like, shut up, like everybody. And then Bryce was like, Gadawak says, shut up, everybody.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, I don't need this right now. So I just shut it down. I was like, I'm done with chat. I'll just watch the show, whatever. And then at a certain point, I was just like, I don't even have to have the show open. Like, that's an option. That's an option for me. I could just have it turned off. Mm-hmm. And so I turned it off, and it was like this crazy, like, freeing feeling of just like, this is no longer an obligation for me. Like, if I hear that something cool is going down, or if like someone awesome is on the show, like if they get Connolly on one of these days again, or if they get like just someone really fun,
yeah,
like I'll probably tune in for something like that. But you know, just day to day. And the thing that I found is I've seen so many episodes of Brian and Justin. Like, so many hours of my life have been listening to them talk to each other and their rapport.
And they're doing a lot of that lately with Night Attack, just kind of solo or duo episodes with them. Because they're still, like, trying to get... I feel like they're like, trying to get over some hump from the transition.
Right.
Before they start going after, you know, newer, wilder, out-of-the-circle guests, I feel like.
Yeah. And like, so I've heard them talk so much that I can hear them in my head. I mean, not like in a crazy person way, but like
I think in a crazy person way.
I mean, maybe that too. But the thing that I found is, so you know, Leon, the best person in the world, writes up show notes for the episodes every week, and yeah. It's nice because not only is it like up pretty much as soon as the episode's over, but also, he does a little bit of editorializing sometimes, where he's like, "And this is a really dumb thing that happened, and everybody got butt hurt." But like it, I found that just reading through that show notes, like I could,
you got it.
I could pretty accurately visualize all of the conversations that happened and the stories that were told, and the way that everybody reacted to it. And obviously, you know, like I'm not gonna pick up on some of the meme culture that developed out of that episode, but I feel like in 30 seconds I got the Night Attack experience as I know it, and I didn't have to waste my whole night on dealing with stuff.
Yeah, and it's because it is long, right? You do pre-show, and if the pre-show is a whole hour, or if the show starts late, so the pre-show could be an hour and a half, and then the show itself can be an hour to 2 hours. And then however long post-show is going to be, if they decide to bust out Hearth and Oates. Yeah, I mean, it definitely is a time sink, and it's a temptation. And once you have it up and you start getting into it, then it's like, well, it's on. I'm watching it. So that's what I'm doing for the next 4 or 5, 6 hours. Right. And I can't focus on something else. Like I kind of intentionally set up what I have to do next on Scam School that way, because the next thing I need to do is make a lot of graphics, and I can actually listen to something or watch something else while I put together some Photoshop PNGs.
Yeah. Anyway, I think we've been on that long enough.
Enough about Brian.
But would you have anything else on the
Let me check. Just real quick. So we got some stuff in development that we can't really talk about, but there's new exciting stuff.
We should have a coming up segment, but a lot of the stuff that we're working on.
We don't want to get into that. Because this is every business would have this problem in terms of you don't always know how something will
stuff
pan
changes.
Out. Yeah, and
sure.
Or if how something will end up being different than how it's supposed to be now, and for good or bad. But
yes. I don't know. So I've got.
Like, I wouldn't talk about any of the upcoming releases,
right?
Just because I'm like, well, I also don't know if that's going to be released, or if it's going to be released next week or 3 years.
Or
from now.
If we order one and we're like, no, actually, this is kind of dumb.
or change stuff. Like, I'll take a recent release, though, for example, like the Sonic Nausea. We added magnets to all those. So there's a couple other places you can find that if you hunt down for it. But ours is the only one that includes magnets pre-installed on all the batteries, so you can attach it anywhere.
Yeah.
But that was something that we decided to do at a later time.
And then the only thing I have left, and I don't know if this is going to break out into a larger discussion, but
it's fine. I think DTNS is already over, so we have another hour
there we go.
Plus.
Almost
hey, hour. unless some of us have work to do too.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah. I've got a behind the scam on my laptop right now that I need to edit. But yeah, so recently Brian was featured on Magic Magazine.
Yeah, we got some right there.
You guys hear about this?
I believe I have heard him.
I still need to read the article in full.
It's a good like little life story about Brian.
The presentation and everything is awesome. Yeah. I'm assuming Brian has showed
this
off.
That's a good photo. Whoever took that photo should be given.
Yeah, there you go.
Pay raise.
Yeah, and so that's Brian's going to talk quite a bit about that in the Behind the Scam that's going to be released this upcoming week or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like it's very clearly a big deal for Brian. Like Magic Magazine is kind of a staple. You sort of have to be with a name like that. Right. Like
his definitive. Whole thing is like, I've been wanting this for the 20 years that I've been doing magic.
Sure, sure. So like, obviously, it's a big deal for him. Mm-hmm. It's a big accomplishment for him.
Yeah.
I can respect that. That's fine.
Yeah.
That's cool. But let's talk about these photographs.
Oh, you want to talk about it? I don't know how much we should get.
We spend a lot of time taking good photos.
We spent
a full day doing like a full on photo shoot and stuff like that.
Two or three.
But yeah, you took some extra time out for like during stand ups. You went and shot some extra photos and stuff like that. And trust me, this will branch out into a larger discussion. Okay. that's less focused specifically on Magic Magazine.
Oh, so you're saying in general.
Sure. But also, like, I was a little bit frustrated. I was a little bit frustrated. Because, first of all, they didn't use any of my photos. I'm just saying.
Did they not use any?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, man.
I think they used... So like
I know they use some Scam School screenies.
Yeah, they used a few Scam School shots. And they used like, two from you, I believe. Mm-hmm. We spent a bunch of time shooting photos, and then they ended up using like a lot of Scam School screenshots, which I guess kind of makes sense because that's sort of a big deal or whatever. But then it's like, also, did we just waste a bunch of time?
Yeah,
Brian will use.
Yeah, Brian's been posting a lot on like Instagram and as his profile photos, and that's awesome. Like that's. That means more to me than actually being featured in Magic Magazine.
Oh, yeah.
Right? But also, so there's this weird thing of, and this is the overarching point, is like, how do you feel about releasing creative control? Right? Because, like, for me, even the photos that were offered, I probably wouldn't have chosen all of those. I probably would have chosen a couple, maybe, but, like, for me, like, to see a creative vision and then to, like work a lot on it and then to say, okay, now I...
You decide.
Yeah, like, I cannot have any further say in what happens. Mm-hmm. Like, that's so tough for me, personally.
Yeah, it's... I would say that, yeah, I like how that's kind of an overarching thing because you see that in a lot of things. Like, and one of the things that I always keep in mind is especially with the scam stuff related things, you get to a point where your perspective on it is from doing all the work on it. So like there's a couple projects like we're working on now, we're trying to figure out price and that kind of thing. And it's like, I was telling Brian this earlier today, I was like, I'm the worst person to like decide this because I just have so much other stuff connected to it. Like, And that's actually why Brian and I work really well in like doing the email stuff because, you know, I kind of the way I start writing it is basically from a like logistical standpoint, and then that's super boring and dumb to read. And then Brian comes in and changes it for, you know, what actually makes sense for someone who's interested in reading.
He gives it character.
Yeah, it gives it some character, that kind of thing. And I wouldn't know specifically for the Magic Magazine stuff, but it's you kind of go in with how you want stuff to be, but yeah, in any team scenario, like I'm sure this is the case with like Apple and, you know, any version of the iPhone or Apple Watch and that sort of thing, where you come in with a, you know, oh, really, this is kind of the vision of what it should be, but then you have all these different perspectives on it, and it's like, you know, the one team says, well, you know, the battery life will only be an hour if this happens, or you know, it'll be too expensive if that happens, that kind of thing. And so I totally get that frustration, mm-hmm. in terms of, like, you know, especially when you've dedicated a lot of time to a project and you have kind of a certain way, and all of a sudden it makes a ton of things make sense in your mind for doing it a certain way. But I do think overall it's good hygiene to let someone else either take it over at some point or kind of have, and of course, I mean, you can see this with certain companies where it becomes out of hand and hurtful to products. I think everyone has different, you know, examples of things that are like that.
Well, I think we do a good job of kind of staying in our lane a little bit, right? Like, definitely saying when we think something doesn't look right or wrong or whatever, but it's not like everybody giving input on everything as SOP. Like, there's a lot of just like individual decision making, I guess.
Sure.
Mm.
Speak for yourself, Bryce. Yes. Brian's controlling me right now.
But yeah, so like for me, also speaking to like relinquishing creative control, mm-hmm. when you kind of came on board and we're like, okay, we're going to divvy up some Scam School work to Bryce, like I kind of had the option of saying like one of two ways. Either one, we can alternate weeks, which is what I inevitably came up with, or not came up with, but chose. Mm-hmm. And the other option was like a kind of a relay system where like you would A-roll it and you would go through like the multicam stuff and then send it to me and then I would do like polish work on it.
Oh,
or stuff like that.
And yeah.
Yeah. And so that way, basically that would push you into doing all the menial stuff that I really don't want to do. But I ended up...
That's what I would have done if I... And new guy can do all the stuff I don't want to do.
Yeah, sure. But I went with the split system, one because it was cleaner. Like
Other way would be so inefficient.
Yeah. But it was pretty tough for me because even though like I take a certain amount of pride in what I've been able to do for Scam School, mm-hmm. but like I very much absolutely see Scam School as I definitely see Scam School as like that is Brian's project. Like, I don't claim any ownership over any of that because I just, like, I can't let myself care about it because it's magic and it's teaching stuff and it's stuff that I just don't care enough about to take any stake in claiming ownership or anything. But, like, obviously it's Brian's project for, like, a billion years.
So you didn't feel
it's super personal for him.
So you didn't feel the need to have that extra editorial control over every episode?
Well,
is that
over the past year, I, like... So I pushed it in some new directions, and, you know, I'm definitely a perfectionist, and I definitely get, like, really deep into my work. And so being able to, like, say, here, you have your own take on it, like, if that varies from how I would do things, like, that can kind of be a little infuriating of, like, oh, I'm trying to do this thing here. Yeah. Right, like,
but you A-rolled it like this, and it's all screwy now. Like,
right, and you know, it's like I've got this long-term vision, and I'm trying to push something in a certain way, and then it's like if you're not going in that direction as well, then there's like a certain break in tone or production or whatever.
Yeah.
And so like that's really tough for me. And thinking back, like on any project I've ever done, like. Back to college and high school and like anything creatively I've done, I've always been either the sole creative or the lead.
Yeah.
And so I've always had kind of like final say in how something comes out. Yeah. Because I feel like I have a good eye for that, a good taste of high quality production stuff. And so for me to, you know, at first I wanted like you to do your full episode and then send me a cut, mm-hmm. and then I would review it. And then once I approved the edit, then we could send it to Brian and he could do like a once over.
I did that.
We did that for times. Like one, maybe two episodes.
I think, yeah, the first two.
But then we just kind of phased out of it. And now it's great because, like, I just trust that you're probably doing fine. Like, yeah.
And I'm still going through Brian.
Yeah, sure. So there's definitely an umbrella to that sort of process that we both fall under. But, I mean, it's been... I really love that you have, like, your own take. And sometimes you'll definitely do stuff differently than I would. And it's definitely good to have a different voice in that sort of project.
Yeah.
And really, like, to be able to not just have an insane amount of work, it's totally worth having it not be my thing. And since I can't claim any ownership or whatever, like, it makes it a little bit easier to just say, there you go.
Yeah.
Have fun. Yeah. But yeah, it's still tough from time to time where I'm just like, I
wouldn't have done that.
South by So Wasted, like, there were a couple things in that where it's like, all right.
Oh.
Yeah, but, like...
Well, and South by So Wasted, you know, that was, like, a... Like, I was literally, like, told...
a day or two edit, and it's right. Just like, gotta get it out, gotta get it out.
I mean, no, I was told that in no uncertain terms. Don't spend more than 1 or 2 days on it. Like,
you know. For me, like, spending 1 or 2 days is like, all right, so, like, a 50-hour workday. Okay, yeah, sure. I can do that. Yeah. Let's try this crazy, insane experiment.
Brian didn't give you that device that slows down time yet? That really helps me.
Oh man. But yeah, so, like, being able to do that is important, although...
To detach a little bit.
Sure. And it's a work in progress for me. But also, when it comes to, like, design work, that's really tough for me to... work on and then give up creative control to design work, because, like, even with Scam School, like, I've spent a long time, like, developing assets for it and a new aesthetic for it that I feel like you've kind of been able to sort of plug in.
Oh yeah,
definitely. And so, like, that helps maintain sort of the style that I've built for it, which makes it way easier to release creative control, because if you came in and you were like, all right, we're doing, like, this other crazy stuff, and then I'd be like, okay.
You would probably maybe roll over a little bit. Or you would compromise in a way that you wouldn't want to because you spent so much time on it.
Yeah, yeah. And so, I mean, that would be a long-term, like, back and forth for that kind of thing. So,
well, I'm glad I chose not to go that route and just steamroll. It's just like,
yeah,
Scam School circus theme now, let's go.
Well, I don't even always watch your episodes these days, so you could be doing something crazy that I don't even know about. But yeah, so when we talk about, like, Magic Magazine, that's really tough for me to say, okay, here's my work, right. Like, I want you to feature this. I want you to, like, showcase this in some regard. And then to see, like, their selection is tough for me, just to be like, to see the narrative that they are stringing together.
Mm-hmm. Which is very much a life story thing.
Yeah. And to see, like, how that might differ from the narrative that I would string together. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing too. That is the thing. I mean, our perspectives on all that stuff would be way too inside baseball for
sure.
A general audience, which is what they're going for. But I do get what you're saying. Like, even because they pulled stuff from the Scam School book that I made, like, years ago. And even when they sent stuff for the physical Scam School book, mm-hmm. when it was Scam School book one was being made into the physical book, and then you see stuff and it's like, but at just some point you have to let it be a separate project that a different team is taking on. But yeah, they reused a few of those things, and yeah. I thought it was interesting how they displayed it. But I was like, if you don't know the context of these images, otherwise this probably makes perfect sense, and it kind of has a cool look to it, I guess. But it was almost like, because I created it. I feel like whenever I'm critical of it, it's because I made it, and I'm like, well, that's not good enough to be in the magazine. Right. Why is that showing up there? But it's like, it's probably fine.
So hold on.
Yeah.
Like, how would you feel if they ended up showcasing that first cover design we got for the Scam School physical book? Do you remember that?
Yeah, I don't want to talk too much about that. But
wait, I don't.
It was pretty funny.
There was some. That's the other thing too. I think kind of our company culture is more of a, like, for Brian to approve something or know you're in the right direction, you have to have a lot more put together than I think most businesses would have. So I think what we were seeing, because I think the book ended up being really, really nice.
Yeah, totally.
And I think what we saw there was just a different progression in terms of, like, they were showing us stuff early that I don't think they expected us to respond well to. But before they spent all the time on a design,
gotcha,
you know, they didn't want us to be like, oh, you're in the total wrong direction. So especially, yeah, working more with them, that's kind of the impression that I get in terms of why it's like that. But it's funny because, you know, when we send stuff to each other, or, you know, like when I saw the Sonic Nausea video, it was done. And then it's like, oh, great, I can put it up. But in a different environment, you would have gotten that project earlier. You would have sent us, you know, some kind of draft or like thumbs. Yeah, that kind of thing.
It would have been passed around. Everybody would have given.
Yeah, and you know, with some businesses that probably makes a whole lot of sense, and they have the budget to do that. But for us, running with a small number of people and having a lot of projects going on,
we just don't have time to waste.
Yeah, we would rather see it almost done and just nip and tuck here and whatever. And because
no time for bureaucracy.
Doing it the way we did it ended up making a lot of sense, because I was confident in what you would give me, and if it was horrible, I would have told you something and not and delayed it.
Yeah.
But it was perfectly workable, and not only that, but I thought really awesome, and it worked out great. So.
Well, I think,
but not everyone will have that approach.
Yeah, sure.
Well, and I think what sort of lends itself to success in that is, aside from Scam School, which has a pretty hard, mostly hard and fast deadline, everything else, we're like, Brian is understandably flexible of like, oh, well, this thing got delayed, so we'll change it to this other thing. Like, it's not Brian like being rigidly like, no, it must be done now and this way, and there's a lot of fluidity, which allows us to go faster, which allows us to be streamlined. If I didn't just give you 20 buzzwords, like,
that's fine.
Did it make sense?
Hashtag
synergy.
I mean, that sounds about right. You know, we're pretty good about moving around stuff. I mean, we have to be with, like, as last minute as so many of our projects end up being, that we have to be super agile and mobile and stuff.
Although I think that is becoming more common in other places too. I know when I was working in Orlando, I was initially surprised by the same kind of, it was like, oh, this thing just came up and now it's a, you know, this project's on fire and needs to be done today. And yeah, I mean, that was, there was probably 100 people working there. So it's, a lot of it may also be, and again, wasn't alive and working during previous time periods of human history,
sure,
but that might also be another thing where it's like, well, we have the resources to, you know, you're not going through and cutting up film and splicing it together to create like your edit, right? So and while it still takes a lot of work, the fact that it's possible, there's kind of that demand for it to be that, you know, fast.
Sure.
And so, which ends up, you know, I would say it ends up making it more difficult today, even though we have easier tools, because that expectation, because that's what all the, you know, all the other channels and how much content they have, and, you know, us wanting to provide kind of a similar amount to our fans.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds good. So I think that was like the bulk of what we had to discuss.
That was good.
Today.
I think we hit a good spectrum of like topics and getting a good, like a pretty good understanding of what we all do and what our
roles are.
Yeah.
In relation to Bizarre Magic and Diamond Club and
sure.
all yeah. these other things, you know?
Someone's asking what the next product to be up at Scam Stuff is. I told you I'm not telling.
You have to wait.
No exclusives here.
Yeah. So but we do have new stuff every Friday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I guess last thing would just be plugs, I guess, just Twitters or where we want anybody to go, maybe, if they like us.
Yeah, that sounds good. We'll work on getting an RSS feed out or something mm-hmm. for audio, and we'll probably end up having video on BBpedia videos.
Exactly.
But other than that, like, if you have any comments or questions, just hit us up on Twitter. I'm Gatowag, GATOWAG.
I'm Brycas on Twitter, at BRYCAS.
And John's not on Twitter. At John Tilton on Twitter, no H in John. But... yeah, I'm taking a little hiatus
Use your Twitter? Is that what I heard? Like, she filters information because of the Star Wars thing.
Yeah, so she'll look at it every now and then. She'll check Facebook every now and then. When I know stuff is kind of dead on Buzz, like after, like right now it's kind of dangerous because the newest trailer was out.
Yeah.
But you kind of get a feel for it. But, and, you know, I've seen things here and there, but I was talking to someone the other day, and it was like, I knew way less than I thought I knew. And they were like, how would you ever avoid this? And I was like, I don't know. I'm trying pretty hard. But so yeah, I'm not putting out too much content right now. But yeah. As of December 19th, I'll probably be back on that.
Yeah, so just let us know, and we'll tell John.
Is good. We'll set up an email or a website or something. We'll figure that out. That's easy junk. So I guess, should we have like an end tag? Should we have like a closing?
Well, so we will be back next month.
Next month. We're trying to do this once a month or so.
Yeah, that's a real like low stress, easy thing to schedule out. Just, I guess we'll do end of the month every month or whatever, more or less. So this was our April episode. Yeah.
Keep being bizarre.
The guys behind the cameras and are now in front of the mics. Until next time.
That's good. We should never have a new.
It should be exactly that.